Everyone, whether you're here with us at the Mesa Lab or joining us virtually, thank you so much for sharing your time with us today for this Explorer Series lecture, Air Quality from Space, with Dr. Peter Nell Lavelt. I am Dr. Evie McCumber, and I am an educator here at the National Science Foundation's National Center for Atmospheric Research, or NSF-NCAR. NSF-NCAR is a world-leading organization dedicated to understanding Earth system sciences, including our atmosphere, weather, climate, the sun, and the importance of all of these systems to our society. I am really glad that y'all are joining us today to learn more about how satellites in outer space can tell us about life on Earth. For this event, you'll be able to ask Peter Nell questions following the lecture, and Aaliyah will help moderate so that we can ensure that we hear from both our in-person and virtual audience. If you're in person, you can just raise your hand. We will run to you and give you a microphone. Then you will have some time to ask your question. If you're joining us virtually, you can ask your questions using the Slido platform. If you are virtual, if you scroll down this webpage, you can see the Slido window just below where you are seeing the live stream of this event. If you haven't already, also this applies to y'all. Go ahead and click on the green Join Events button, and you can go ahead and ask questions on the Q&A tab. Peter now also has a few poll questions for us. Don't worry, it's not a pop quiz. You don't need to know all of the answers ahead of time. So for both our in-person and virtual audience, you can respond on Slido. If you are in person, you can use your phone or laptop to navigate to slido.com and enter the code #ExplorerSeries. And definitely, be sure to join Slido to add your thoughts to our word cloud. What do you think of when you hear the words air quality? Because we are going to get to that really soon. This event is also being recorded and will be available on the NSF-NCAR Explorer Series website if you want to revisit it. With us today, we have NSF-NCAR Associate Director and Scientist Peter Nell Lavelt. Professor Peter Nell Lavelt has been director of the NSF-NCAR's Atmospheric Chemistry Observations and Modeling Lab since June of 2021. Her scientific expertise is in performing and interpreting satellite observation of the Earth's atmospheric chemical composition in the context of climate change, air quality, and the ozone layer. In 2018, she received the NASA USGS PCORA Award, and in 2021, the AMS Special Award on behalf of the International OMI Science Team. In April of 2021, she was knighted in the Order of the Dutch Lion. Dr. Lavelt studied chemistry at the Free University of Amsterdam, obtaining her master's degree in physical chemistry and then her PhD in physics. Professor Lavelt became the principal investigator of the OMI instrument, which launched on NASA's EOS Aura satellite in 2004, and is still responsible for the International Scientific Program of OMI. She is a scientific founder of the Dutch ESA Tropomi satellite instrument that launched on the ESA EU Sentinel-5 precursor in 2017. Dr. Lavelt was the head of the Research and Development Department on Satellite Observations at KNMI, the Royal Netherlands Meteorological Institute in the Netherlands, which she's still affiliated with. Professor Lavelt is a professor in remote sensing of the Earth atmosphere at University of Technology Delft, which is also still ongoing. Dr. Lavelt is a member of the mission advisory groups at ESA for the EU Copernicus Sentinel-4, 5 missions, and has chaired ESA's S5 precursor Tropomi MAG. She co-chairs the NITROSAT mission, one of ESA's Earth Explorer missions in Phase Zero that focuses on the nitrogen cycle. Now, before I turn it over to Peter Nell, let's check out your thoughts on our word cloud. Paul and Joey, may you please share Slido with us. Let's see what you think about when you think of air quality. Huh. Pollution, the measure of how perfect the air is, pollution levels or pollutants, smog, clear, oxygen. Peter Nell, what do you think of these answers and what did our audience do? How do they do?
Well, I think they're all relevant. And there are reasons for that to do that, and I hopefully show some of that in this presentation.
Sure. Yeah. All yours.
Thank you. So thank you for the very nice introduction. I'm going to talk about air pollution, air quality measurements from space. And I'm wondering how I get the first slide on. Okay, good. I will talk about two satellite instruments which I'm originated. I'm still the principal investigator, the scientific leader of one of those. And the other one, I was the scientific founder. But I will start with explaining a bit about why is it so important, this atmospheric composition? Why do we need to have this knowledge for life on Earth? And I will also show you in this presentation that when you measure air quality, that you measure indications of human activity. I hear some sounds. Okay. And I hope to be able to convince you that we can indeed see human activities like traffic and industry with satellite instruments from space. I will end with talking about Africa. And that's a new ambition we have here at NCAR to perform satellite measurements over Africa. So I will start with this image. And this image shows you air pollution, one specific component, it's called nitrogen dioxide, measured by the second satellite instrument, TROPOMI. And you see it's a global measurement. That's one of the advantages of satellite measurements, that you measure the whole globe. That means that when you have a measurement over Europe or the United States or Asia, that you can compare these measurements directly. And that's a very, very big difference with, for example, ground-based measurements, where you can ask yourself, and there are measurements in another country, are they calibrated well? How do they treat the instrument? So you have questions about that. But when you have one instrument measuring the whole globe, you can directly compare these measurements. That's a big advantage of satellite observations. There are also disadvantages, but that's one of the big advantages. So what you see here is nitrogen dioxide. And nitrogen dioxide is produced by fossil fuel burning. So that means that you see traffic, industry, and power plants. And the red values in this image are high values of nitrogen dioxide. And the blue values are very low values. And all the other colors are in between. So you clearly see that when we have red values, that they are on areas where a lot of people live. So you see Europe, you see the Po Valley sticking out there. Let's see if I can do something with this for that. Or I have to put it here. You see it in the largest big red thing is the Po Valley. We see China. And we see also the major cities in the United States, like LA and Washington and New York. When you go more to the south, you look at South Africa and South America and Africa, you see a little bit higher levels of nitrogen dioxide. They are related to biomass burning, basically mainly agriculture practices in Africa and South America, which they still use for the agriculture crop. So they burn on regular times during the year, they burn their land, and that's what we can measure. You also see that we can measure ship emissions. One of the largest ship emission tracks is between India and Indonesia. And we can also measure that from space. Okay, so now there will be a Slido question related to the red spot in South Africa.
Yes. And that question is, what may be the main cause of high nitrogen dioxide levels in Johannesburg, South Africa? What do those answers look like to you, Peter, now?
The main cause of that red spot is not biomass burning. It's power plants in combination with industry. So there is a high field near Johannesburg. I've been there in 2017. And there are 12 power plants with a lot of industry around it near Johannesburg. And they produce a lot of pollution. And that's why we see that big red spot near Johannesburg. Yeah, I can go on. Okay, so we make global measurements, but the measurements are so good that we can also focus on specific areas in the globe. And what you see here is the Netherlands. That's the country I come from. And you see a lot of red stuff there. We have quite some air pollution in the Netherlands. We are a very high populated country. And you see, for example, red blob around Amsterdam, where I still have a house. I come from near Rotterdam, the harbor and the city, Antwerp, Ruhr area. And you see also Schiphol. And that is, you might have been there because it's the airport near Amsterdam. And with this new instrument, with TROPOMI, we are able to measure that pollution from Schiphol as distinct from Amsterdam. So it's not one blob anymore. We can really isolate the pollution from Schiphol. And we are not able to do that before we had this instrument in space. But now I live here. And that same instrument also measures here. So I asked my lab, the lab I'm now leading is starting to work more and more with the TROPOMI data to make this image. And you see the nitrogen dioxide pollution again. You see Denver, you see Boulder, you see all the cities, and you also see the highways. So that's what we can measure nowadays from space, all this pollution with a very, very high spatial resolution. I think we have a Slido question now.
What percentage of our atmosphere is carbon dioxide? I am surprised by the answers and the fact that what is the correct answer, Peter, now?
It's the first one, less than 0.1.
I would have expected 28. Or something higher. Yeah.
So that's very, very good. And that's correct. So let's look at the composition of the Earth atmosphere. And that's this one. And what are the main components there? So we learned at school about 80% is nitrogen, 20% is oxygen, 1% is argon. And then we have a very tiny amount, 0.036%, which basically has all the trace gases I'm going to talk about in this presentation. So it has all the greenhouse gases, CO2 and methane. It has the complete ozone layer. It has all the air pollutants in the tiny amount. And it's actually striking to think about that has such a strong influence on life on the Earth. And for me personally, it's even more striking that we can measure all these trace gases from space now, using satellite instruments, circling the Earth at around 700-800 kilometers altitude. Okay, so I go now to why do we need to study the atmosphere composition? So the area we are currently living in was called by the Dutch Nobel Prize winner Paul Crutzen the Anthropocene. And the Anthropocene refers to the fact that we put all kinds of emissions in the atmosphere. And you see Paul Crutzen there on a photo on the roof of KNMI, the Dutch Met Office where I used to work, on the day he got the Nobel Prize. He was visiting KNMI, and we got all the media on top of that. I was at that time already working at KNMI. But Paul was also the one who actually initiated the lab I'm currently leading here at NCAR. He was the first director of this atmosphere chemistry lab. And on top of that, he was the originator of the idea to put spectrometers in space to measure air pollution from space. So Paul had quite a strong influence on my professional life. So when you look at the atmosphere composition, there are three main themes we study. One is the ozone layer, recovery of the ozone layer. Ozone layer is important for life on Earth because it protects us against the harsh UV radiation. For that, we can get skin cancer, for example. It's important for air quality and also for climate change with the greenhouse gases. And you see here the major emissions. So you see on the left top left the so-called CFCs. These are mainly caused by cooling agents we use and which destroy the ozone layer very, very effectively. We also have a lot of emissions from industry and traffic. and, of course, from biomass burning, agriculture burning, or wildfires. So the atmosphere is, chemistry is fascinating, but also very challenging. If you really want to understand it, and this is a kind of schematic overview, then you need to know a lot. So you have to have knowledge about the emissions, some cities, from traffic, but also natural emissions from volcanoes. You have to have knowledge about chemistry, homogeneous chemistry, heterogeneous chemistry, transport, exchange with land, with ocean, solar radiation impact on photochemical chemistry, for example. So we try to understand all of this in the lab I'm currently leading with many, many methods. One of them is satellite, but we also use models and ground-based instrumentation, aircraft instrumentation. Today, I will only talk about satellites. So you further see a set of trace gases. Completely on the left, you see CO2 and methane. And CO2 and methane are the two most important greenhouse gases. Then you see a whole list starting with nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide. These are old air pollutants, so they are toxic. And then you see ozone and aerosols separately. And they are on a different position because they have a dual role. They influence climate and they influence, they are all both toxic. So they have a dual role in the air pollution and in climate. And what is also important to recognize is that ozone is not something we emit. It's formed in the atmosphere by chemistry from methane with the air pollutants. And aerosols, at least 50%, probably more, is also formed in the atmosphere, so not directly emitted. And that is also formation with the same set of chemicals. So that means also that the air pollutants and greenhouse gases, methane, are linked in their chemistry. And that means that when you make policy for air pollution or for climate, that these policies will impact each other. And in most countries, the policymakers for air pollution are in a different department than the policymakers for climate. So that's one of the things we are dealing with now with the COP meetings, basically. Okay, so one slide about the ozone layer. So you see here ozone measured by my first instrument, which is still measuring, actually, OMI. For 2018, we can make this movie every year. And you see basically the formation of the ozone hole over the Antarctic, over the South Pole. It starts around end of August, finishes about half December. So now when you see this dark blue and black, it's really all the ozone between 14 and 20 kilometers has been destroyed by these cooling agents. Very, very effectively within 2 weeks. So it's very, very aggressive. For this, we made the Montreal Protocol to protect the ozone hole, to get it recovering. And we are successful, actually, in that. So the Montreal Protocol tries to limit these cooling agents, the CFCs. And we can measure with other satellite instruments that that is effective. And we also now see it in the recovery of the ozone layer. So what is good to know is that the assessment of the Montreal Protocol is fully based on satellite measurements, mostly based, let's say 80-90%. For air pollution and greenhouse gas assessment of protocols, it's mainly based on ground-based instrumentation. So that's a big difference between this type of protocols. And one of the things I'm advocating for is also to start satellite data to use that for air pollution and greenhouse gas monitoring. And what is further important to know is the Montreal Protocol has also a big win-win for climate, basically, because the CFCs are very, very strong greenhouse gases. And by reducing them, we actually have a smaller climate change than we would have had without the Montreal Protocol. And at the point we put this Montreal Protocol in place, this was not, we were not really aware of it. It was not part of the discussion on that level to put the protocol in place. Okay, so now I go to the other themes, air pollution and greenhouse gases. I start with air pollution. When we think of air pollution, we usually think of China. And here you see a clean day for a Chinese city, and this is a polluted day for the same city. This is not fog. These are tiny particles. These are aerosols. And everyone who has been in China, and I've been there twice, has seen this. If you're there a week or 2 weeks in Beijing, Nanjing area, you will see both situations. So that is a lot of pollution, but China is not the only country with pollution. So when we look at the air pollution globally, and this is an image which is made by the World Health Organization, and you see the impact from outside air pollution on premature death. We have 4.2 million people who die earlier than when we would not have had this air pollution. So that's quite a big impact. And it's actually striking to realize that we are not really aware of that. So when we are talking about pollution of food or water, we are very, very aware of that. We are not going to eat or drink that, no way. But we have pollution in the air, and we breathe it every day. And we are not really, really aware of that we do that. And we can live months without food, days without water, and only a couple of minutes without air. So it should be something which we could raise on a higher level of attention. I think I have a slide on now.
Yeah. Following up on this, could we please bring up the slider question that asks, what place in the global risk factor for premature death is taken by air pollution?
That's a high ranking. So this, the people who are here are really aware of it. That's clear, because it's the fourth place. And so then we go to the next slide to see that. And you see it on the lower right. So what we look here at is an result from a paper in the Lancet, and here they look at air pollution inside and outside, so in-house, outside. If you combine that, then we are talking about 7 million premature death a year, and in that listing, if you take that listing, then it's the fourth global risk factor of which we die prematurely. And we have very high rates in Africa and Asia, and that's what you see in this image. Okay, then climate. So climate change is more and more in the attention, and we all know that CO2 is the largest greenhouse gas. And you see that here in this image, which is one of the IPCC images. You see that on the horizontal axis, we have the effective radiative forcing, which basically tells you how large the heating effect is of a certain greenhouse gas. So CO2 has the largest bar, and that's the most important one. But the next one is methane. And you see two colors there if you're not colorblind. And the orange one is the direct effect of methane, the heating effect of methane. The green part is the heating effect of ozone. And as I told you, ozone is only formed in the atmosphere, don't emit it. And it's formed in chemistry initiated by methane. So when you have methane as greenhouse gas, it has an effect, but also the formation of toxic ozone due to methane has an extra heating effect. So this is something new, which we are now more and more aware of. I think last 10 years it has been a major topic at the COP and also the IPCC report to make that clear. And that means that methane has become a more important greenhouse gas because the effect is so large, larger than previously thought. And on top of that, methane has a much shorter lifetime than CO2. So when you reduce methane, you will be faster, probably already in decadal timescale, effective in cooling, basically, or not so much heating of the atmosphere. And then the last point, I think, that made it more and more visible are the satellite measurements. So Tropomi is the first instrument which really can get global coverage of methane measurements. And the instrument was launched in 2017, and it is really, really effective in showing how much methane there is. And I think that this type of measurements and visuals, which you will see later in the talk, have a big impact in how people appreciate this type of information. So I think that also had a big impact. So we now have the so-called methane pact, and also in the last COP28, that is an important development and is now signed by 155 countries to reduce methane with 30% in 20 or 30 years from now. Okay, now I'm going to talk about the satellite instruments. And I talk about the European part of this type of instrumentation. And the instruments we use, we call solar backscatter. So these are spectrometers, and I will explain in one or two slides further how that works. You see here a whole list of instruments. So the top five, with all these fancy names, they're all designed and built mainly by Dutch industry. So we have very, very elaborate industry in Holland who is really, really good in designing and building this type of instruments. I will talk about OMI, which is the third one, and TOPOMI, which is the fifth one, the orange. You see also two green bars, and these bars are for future instrumentation, which Europe is going to launch. So Sentinel 5 will be a follow-on instrument for TOPOMI. And Sentinel 4 will be the first instrument in a geostationary orbit. So all these instruments are what we call polar satellites. So they fly from pole to pole around the Earth at about 700 kilometers altitude. But Sentinel 4 will be a geostationary satellite. And it means that it will move. If you hang it above the US, it will move with the US. If it's above Europe, it will move with Europe during the day. So that means that you can make measurements during the day. And we can make about 8 to 10 measurements during the day with a geostationary satellite. With a polar, you only cross once a day. And for OMI and TOPOMI, that's about 1:30 in the afternoon. Okay, so OMI and TOPOMI. On the left, you see three very happy PIs receiving the PIKORA Award for the OMI instrument. So it was launched in 2004 on the EOS-Aura satellite. And it's myself in the center. On this side is Joanna Termine. It's my Finnish co-PI because it's a Dutch Finnish instrument, OMI. Electronics comes from Finland. And on the right, you see Joanna Joyner, and she works at NASA Goddard Space because it was launched on a NASA satellite. And it's very, very rare that you have three female PIs in this space community. So there are many things why we're very proud of this achievement. What OMI was able to do, and it was really a game changer, is measuring daily global coverage, so the whole atmosphere in one day, every day, with very high spatial resolution, 13 by 24 kilometers. Then with TOPOMI, we were able to improve this. And you see here TOPOMI on the right is a much larger instrument than OMI for many reasons. And you see it here in one of the clean rooms in Airbus in the Netherlands. And that instrument went to 3.5 by 5 kilometer pixels, so 16 times improvement when you look at the surface. And also still daily global coverage. Okay, so how do we measure? The measurement technique. So we use the sun. The sun is our lamp. And what we basically do, we have a spectrometer, and the spectrometer unravels this white light to the rainbow colors. And you see that rainbow on the horizontal axis of the image on the right. So most of the time, we fly from pole to pole. So we look like this, downward, from pole to pole. And that is basically what you see here, where the light is scattered and absorbed by the atmosphere. So it reflects, it's scattered, absorbed, and goes back basically to the satellite instrument. And that gives you the dark curve, the dark blue curve. Once a day, we look directly at the sun, because the sun is our lamp. And we have to calibrate the lamp. And we do that on a daily basis. And that gives you the light blue curve. And when you look now at the numbers on the horizontal axis, you see 250, 500, these are the wavelengths. And you see that all light from the dark blue curve below 300 nanometers is disappeared. And that's caused by the ozone layer. The ozone layer absorbs all that light, protects us against this harsh UV radiation. You also see some dips, deep dips in this, what we call spectrum. And they are connected to specific trace gases. So these trace gases have a kind of fingerprint. they absorb at a specific color of the light. And we know exactly which color they absorb. And the deeper this dip is, the more trace gas there is. So it's basically absorption spectrometry. And it's a very, very simple technique. But in practice, it's very complicated because you have to know a lot about the atmosphere to get the accurate amounts out. But the basic principle is very simple. Okay, so this is the innovation of OMI. So what you see here is a two-dimensional detector. You can compare it to what you use in your phones, where you make photos with. So you have two sides, you have a two-dimensional detector. OMI was the first to use that. And that enabled us to put on one axis the rainbow, the wavelengths, and on the other axis, spatial information. Previous instruments had to have a mirror swapping over the Earth, basically. But we can measure that whole, what you call SWOT, you see the word up there, in one go, because we used a two-dimensional detector. And all instruments after OMI, US, Europe, Asia, doesn't matter, they all use this new innovation. Because that enabled us to get daily global covers with a SWOT of 2,600 kilometers, and at the same time, very high spatial resolution, because we had all this, every pixel in the detector corresponds to a different point on Earth. So when you have one orbit, we fly from pole to pole. This is one orbit. When you fly around 700, 800 kilometers altitude, it takes you 110 minutes. And then you see this is a measurement of TOPOMI, the second instrument. We look at clouds here. And you see that we can see all these clouds because we use this two-dimensional detector. When you calculate in 24 hours, because the Earth is turning below it, we have 14 orbits. And when you do 14 times 2,600, you almost have the equator. And that leads to this daily global coverage. Okay, so now I first talk about OMI. So OMI gave four big new inventions, what we could do with the data to understand the atmospheric composition. And I will explain three of them. So you see here OMI nitrogen dioxide again. It's a global image, same data set. You can also look over Europe. And of course, you can make an image over the Netherlands. And please try to memorize this image more or less. Yeah? Okay, so here you see the new findings due to this instrument. It was caused by many factors, but one, the main factor is the daily global covers and the high spatial resolution, which really enabled us to pinpoint emissions and to have a lot of data. So with that, we improved the air quality forecast. We improved environmental monitoring. So when you put policy in place to reduce air pollution, can we see that from space, that it is reduced or not? And we also used it to calculate emissions, and that I will explain in three slides from now what I mean with that. So I will start now with the environmental monitoring.
Hi, everyone. This is President Barack Obama. NASA's Aura satellite has been tracking global pollution trends for the past decade, and its initial findings have shown us a lot about the state of our atmosphere. The satellite detects gases like nitrogen dioxide, a common pollutant from cars and power plants. The data shows us that the United States and Europe have some of the highest emission levels in the world. But it also shows us that over the last 25 years, nitrogen dioxide levels have dropped by up to 50% in both regions, thanks in large part to new rules that protect our air. At the same time, in China, India, and the Middle East, this pollution has grown dramatically. So imagery like this can help us see what actions are working and where we need to focus additional international efforts. And it proves that we all need to work together to protect the one planet we've got.
So I'm always amazed when I see this movie that he can explain my complete research field in 1 minute and 10 seconds. it takes me an hour to talk to you, and then hopefully I explain some of it. But it's really extremely good communication. And of course, we were very, very proud because all the data you see are from the OMI instrument. And yeah, President of the US is talking about that. There are not a lot of scientists who have that experience in their lives. Now, the second one was air quality forecast. So air quality forecast is like a weather forecast, but then for atmospheric chemistry. And one of the things you see on the news in the evening when you look at the weather forecast, they use this satellite data. And you see these images. Usually there's a geostationary satellite, so you see the clouds changing during the day. But one of the things that's really important for that type of forecast, weather or air quality, is that you have the data fast down and calculated to the product you want to use. So in the OMI project, I took the decision that we would like to have the data in what we call near real time. That means within 3 hours after actual measurement. And that's what we did. So the OMI measurements, you see there, NRT stands for near real time, are available within 3 hours after measurements everywhere around the globe, 24/7. And with this data, you can improve your air quality forecast because you have a check with real measurements if your model forecast is correct. So we used that for global air quality forecast, also for European air quality forecast. Also in the US, these data are used, also OMI by NOAA, for example, for the air quality forecast. And now with top OMI data, everyone is working to get also to high resolution, better forecast, to really use this high resolution data for a country like the Netherlands. Okay, the third one is emissions. So what you see here is a pipe of industry or power plant, and it has a pollution plume. And a plume that is transported by the wind, chemistry takes place. At some point, you have a certain concentration, and that is what we measure with the satellite. We measure the concentration of nitrogen dioxide. But when you want to say something about emissions, you have, so to speak, to calculate backward in time, push the plume back into the pipe because you want to know what came out of the pipe. So you calculate chemistry backward in time and transfer it, and then you know the emission. And that is a technique that was, that model technique has largely started to develop with OMI because you need a lot of data to do that accurately enough. And what you see is on the right, I have one example what that means. So on the top, you see the Middle East, nitrogen dioxide. It's a, what we call a bottom-up emission map. It's based on information from government and industry. So it's a paper exercise, basically. No, there's barely any measurement going into that map above. When you only use the OMI NO2 data, you can get the map below with this new technique. And we can calculate that map in 1 month, 1 or 2 months time frame. But that's the amount of data we need to get a good map. You see these maps are very comparable. What you also see is that they are for 2010. Why is that? It's because this Middle East map is the most recent we have. Because this bureaucratic paper exercise takes a lot of time. And of course, for the United States, you could have it from this year, but for the Middle East, it's a little bit more difficult to get. So I'm already advocating for a long time to use satellite data to update these maps, not throw away the paper exercise, but combine the satellite measurements and the paper exercise to just make it more up to date. And we can do that with the current satellite measurements. Okay, now I go to the second instrument, TOPOMI. So TOPOMI is part of a huge activity in Europe. It's called the European Union Copernicus Sentinels. And they are launched to monitor climate, basically. So there are land instruments, instruments that measure the ocean, and you have instruments that measure the atmosphere. And we actually have 3 instruments here that measure the atmosphere composition. And Sentinel-5P on the lower one, that's the one which carries TOPOMI. You see a small mimic of that there on the table. That's the Sentinel-5P satellite carrying the TOPOMI instrument. And you see Sentinel-4 and 5, of which I already talked, which are follow-on instruments. So Sentinel-5 will follow TROPOMI. Sentinel-4 will be our first geostationary instrument in Europe to measure atmospheric chemistry. I will come back to that later. So what did we improve from OMI to TROPOMI? We have a higher spatial resolution. We have a higher sensitivity per measurement. We added two channels, one to correct for clouds, because we measure in a wavelength range where you cannot, it's the same as your eyes. We cannot look through a cloud, so the instrument cannot do that either. So when we have a pixel with some clouds in it, we want to correct for that as good as possible. And for that, we added a channel to do that. And then we have a channel that measures carbon monoxide, which is also an air pollutant, and methane, the second most important greenhouse gas. And from, I will show you results from nitrogen dioxide again and methane. But here, here's the photo. You see two very happy PIs in the center when the TROPOMI launch was successful. We're here at ESA-ESTEC at Noordwijk in the Netherlands. So I'm on the right. On the left, you see Pepijn Veefkind, who is now the PI of TROPOMI, working at the Dutch Met Office. And why are we so happy? So one of the things a lot of people don't know is that the launch is still the most risky part in a project like this. So the launch is very, very exciting. And we started to think about TROPOMI 1 year before OMI was launched. So 2003, in the year 2003, we had the first ideas about TROPOMI. And we launched the instrument in 2017. So this is really, really long, 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 long time commitment. And then, of course, you really would like, it's, you have only one instrument. There's not a second one somewhere on the ground to launch. You know, so this is your project. So that was, it's always really, really exciting. Okay, so here is the first measurement we made with TROPOMI. It's about 1 month after launch, and we use only three wavelengths. And we can measure with three wavelengths, clouds, land, ocean. But TROPOMI measures 4,000 wavelengths. And you see here four spectra of that. And we have 20 million count pixels per day. And per count pixel, we can get 10 to 15 trace gas products. And this is run operational 24/7. Within 3 hours after measurement, you have these data. So it's 1 terabyte of data per day. So this is really, really huge. I will talk only about two trace gases, so nitrogen dioxide again and methane. So this is the first measurement of TROPOMI on nitrogen dioxide. And this is the moment that all the scientists working on this instrument for years and years and years are running through the hallways of KNMI. Because this is what you do it for. Why did we run? Well, I hope you still remember the OMI nitrogen dioxide image. But what you see is much higher spatial resolution. Holland is very tiny. Yeah? We are 200 by 150 kilometers. That's our size, more or less. And what we also saw is that we see air pollution plumes. So we see the plume going from Amsterdam over the North Sea, pushed over the North Sea, due to the southeastern wind we had on that day. From Rotterdam, from Antwerp, from Ruhr area. So we see the movement in the pollution. And that is the first time we can measure that. TROPOMI is the first instrument globally who can measure that. You cannot measure that from ground because you don't have that whole plume in one view. It's difficult to measure from aircraft because you don't fly fast enough. You need a kind of what we call synoptic view to see it in one go. And so this is really, really new material. And you see that on the right, 10 days later, we have the wind from the north, Scandinavia, North Sea, very clean. That's what you see. And you see the plumes going to the south. So that was, and we also directly saw that the measurements were good. If you look a lot to this type of images, you can directly see it. If the instrument is good, and we saw directly, this instrument is really good. So, well, we don't only measure the Netherlands. So these are averages over April 2018. Also Africa, Middle East, And on the right you see India. And you see that we have a small movie there. And if you look, you see the issues in the southern part, you see small plumes moving with the wind from day to day because this wind field changes from day to day. And these are, most of them are power plants. So we see power plants from space and we also see where the pollution plume from that power plant goes to. Okay, so one of the things that really made Topomi famous, I think, at least from our perspective, was the COVID crisis. COVID was dramatic for everybody, but one of the things that happened is that no one transported his or herself anymore. So we stayed at home. So there was no traffic. And that has influence on air pollution. So it was, for us, a kind of atmospheric experiment which we never would have had. And we were all working from home, like you did, but we were approached by the whole world for our data to look if we saw a decrease in air pollution due to the fact that we were working at home. So we had the New York Times, Washington Post, ESA with several outings, also Dutch television, and it was a very interesting time to be. So one of the things we did was to look at China. So on the left, you see February, March average 2019 over China. You see a lot of pollution. Then on the right, you see 1 year later, February 2020, the lockdown in China, which was really, really stringent. And you see a huge decrease in pollution. And that is mainly caused by transport, no transport, basically, no cars. Power plants continue to work because, otherwise everyone freezes, industry for a large part, but transport, that was cut down. And then 1 month later, surprisingly, 1 month later, I'm still surprised by that, China, when I look back, because I have the feeling we're still not completely over this whole period, but China went back to work. And you see that in an increase in the air pollution. So you see really human activity, what we do, impacting air pollution, and we can measure that from space. Well, ESA, this European Space Agency, had several outings. And you see here, again, 2019 compared to 2020, with a large decrease in air pollution due to the lockdown. And in most large cities like Paris and Madrid, it was almost 50% decrease in air pollution. Okay, now I'm going to talk about methane. So what you see here is methane measured by Topomi. It's an effort over about 6 weeks, starting 1 month after launch. And you see that we can measure methane with a global view. And after seeing all these nitrogen dioxide images, you think, well, why not? But that is really special because at that time, there were only a few other instruments measuring methane, and the most important one is COSAT, still working. And you see the image of COSAT on the right, lower one, and that is not a global, you don't have this coverage over land. And we could provide that due to this two-dimensional detector in the end. So that we have 1,000 times more measurements than COSAT, which means that you can look for emission sources. When you only have a stripe, you also miss a lot of emission sources. But when you have a coverage, you can measure them. And what we also did, we did a direct comparison with COSAT, which is a very accurate methane measurement. And you see that's more or less a one-to-one line. That means that there is no difference, not a bias, as we call it, between those two measurements. And that is also very, very exceptional because methane retrieval is really, really challenging. And usually it takes you years to get the right amount. But this instrument was so good that we directly were on this one-to-one line. And that was also really, really surprising. We didn't expect that. So methane, the second most important greenhouse gas, has many, many sources. Anthropogenic sources and natural sources. And the next slide.
Our last question, which we're going to bring up, is which of the following methane sources is the largest anthropogenic source of methane? And we have livestock, oil and gas, rise forms, and then we have some answers on the top.
Yeah, well.
How did our audience do? Are they in the right track?
Yes. Oh. It's livestock. Yeah, so that's correct. And when you look at methane, it has many different sources. So this same list as you answered the question for. Part of them are natural, like wetlands, and most of the fires. But a lot of them are also anthropogenic. And that is one of the things where they focus on now, also in the last COP28, this for methane at least, that focus for methane was to reduce the anthropogenic sources and to have an agreement on that. So one of the things we did with TopOMI is to start to look at oil and gas. And we first, on the left hand, you see that we first looked at large lakes. So we're looking here at Turkmenistan. And you see three images, one in December, two in January. And the last one in January has a big red blob. So this here on the left-hand side, it's that image. That was a big leak of an oil and gas exploration. And we were able to measure that from space. And the oil and gas exploration was informed and the leak was shut. It's a very remote area. Normally, oil and gas industry knows what's going on, but this is an extremely remote area, and therefore there was no one apparently present at that point in time. On the right, you see what we call regular operations. So we're looking at the Permian here, the largest oil and gas field in the United States. So regular operation means we can look at leak of methane. So everything we cannot get, we lose in the exploration. That's what we are measuring here. And you see that we measure methane and also NO2. And what is special about this is that it's only one day. You see 31st of January 2019. And with the previous instrument from Europe's Kimaki, we had to average over a year to see any methane over this area. And now one day measurement, it's not one day measurement, it is one measurement. Because once, around 1:30 over this area, and the integration time of this instrument is 1 to 2 seconds. And that's what we measure here. So that's really, really a big, it's a game changer basically in our capability to measure methane from space. So on top of that, we have new developments. We have small sats. It's huge development in the satellite business. And one of the small sats is called GHG sat. It's measuring only methane, not also all the other trace gases. TopOMI measures only methane, very high spatial resolution, but no daily global coverage whatsoever. But we can combine these measurements. So we use TopOMI. We see this large leak, for example, in Turkmenistan on the right again. And then this small sat, you can direct. So you know where the leak is. You fly over with a small sat, you direct it to that leak, and you can also follow it. So you can integrate for a long time. And with that, you can get detailed observations of methane. And this combination will be used for this methane pledge, not the only thing, but will be used to see if we are effective in reducing our methane sources. Okay, so I come to my last item, is Africa. So why would we like to measure over Africa? One of the main reasons is that we expect a huge population grow in Africa. So we expect almost more than tripling from now 1.1 billion people to 3.8 in 70 years from now. 70. I think that is never shown before. At the same time, there is an industrial revolution going on in Africa, so that will already lead to more pollution. And that combination will lead to a huge amount of pollution. Pollution and greenhouse gases. And it's important to measure that and to be aware of that. So you see on the left, you see measurements from TopOMI. And you see that Africa has all pollution sources. So we have fossil fuel, which we can see in nitrogen dioxide on the left up. Then next to that, you see carbon monoxide released by biomass burning, wildfire, agriculture burning. On the lower left, you see biogenic emissions. These are emissions from forest mainly. In formaldehyde, one of the pollutants we can measure. And on the right, you see aerosol index, so aerosol from Sahara dust. And at the same time, we can measure this with tropomy, but we barely have ground-based measurements in Africa. And there's also a lack of emission estimates over Africa. We don't have the information. And we need emission estimates to do a proper calculation. If we don't know what's emitted, we cannot calculate the chemistry. So there is an urgent need for a new capability for air quality management for Africa. So I will go a little bit deeper into this now. So this is an image from the Washington Post showing you the 100 largest megacities in 2025, and they are mainly in Asia. This is the prediction. So in 2100, this will be shifted to Africa, and the largest 10 largest megacities will be in Africa by that time. That's what is the expectation. Here you see ground-based measurements. On the left, you see them for ozone, and on the right for aerosols. And you see that most of these ground-based measurements are in the Northern Hemisphere, Europe, US, Asia. There's barely anything in the Global South and also not in Africa. So it means that there is one ground-based instrument per country. Yeah? Africa is a continent per country in Africa. That's a completely different ballpark. In the Netherlands, for this type of measurements, we have 60 of these ground-based, very accurate monitors. And then we have more and more less accurate. So that's a big issue, because we have this satellite crossing once a day, but that's then basically the information you have. And the ground-based instrument, of course, can measure all the time. So you have also, you have really a time evolution over the day. It gives you other information which you really need. And it measures on the ground where we breathe. But it's not easy to build that kind of ground-based systems. It really takes a lot of effort. So at the same time, Africa is just like the other continents. So they also had COVID. You look here at Nigeria, nitrogen dioxide again. On the left, it's April 2019. On the right, it's 2020. And you see a clear decrease in nitrogen dioxide. There are also big differences. And one of the main things is the biomass burning. Biomass burning, since it's an agriculture practice in Africa, is really huge. And shifts over the country from April to June to October, shifts from north to south. You see that in the carbon monoxide and in the NO2 measurements. So that means there are more different emissions in Africa than in other continents. That also from a research point of view, this is really, really interesting. There will be other chemistry going on. So we would like to know more about that. So one of the things we started to do here in this lab in Ankara is to use the tropomy data to look at mining activities, metal mining activities. And we were initiated by that by a New York Times article, 2021, talking about the clean energy revolution and the metals we need for that, for the batteries, basically. So you see that cobalt is mainly from Africa. So we thought, well, can we see that in the satellite data? And why would we see that? We don't measure cobalt. But you use machinery to get this cobalt out. And this machinery is run on diesel. And diesel, that will produce a fossil fuel, nitrogen dioxide. So what you see there on the right is an image which was used in this, a photo which was used in this paper, the New York Times article. You see a city on the left. You see a huge mine on the right. It's a copper cobalt mine. The mine is as large as the city. So we started to look in the tropomy data. Can we see that in our data, this nitrogen dioxide? And can we see it's from the mine and not from the city? And we turned out to be able to see that. So the large NO2 blob we found was from the mine. So we looked at 6 mines in that area, Congo, and we calculated the emission, which I explained to you with the plume back into the pipe. And we combined that emission calculation with production of that mine, which we could find on the internet. So how much cobalt, copper do they produce? And is there a correlation? And there is a strong correlation. So that's what we showed. And it's the first time that this type of calculation is done based on satellite data. So one of the things we are now advocating for from NCAR, UCAR, and we work with a very large community, national, international community for that, is to have also geostationary satellites over the global south. So what you see here is the global atmospheric chemistry constellation. It's all the satellites, Europe, US, Asia. On the lower bar, you see all the polar satellites. So they fly from pole to pole, and Sentinel 5P, the one on the left, is the one with Tropomi. But you see that we also launched geostationary satellites. The one over Asia is already there, GEMS. The one over the United States was launched this year, TEMPO. And the one over Europe will be launched this year or next year. But you also see that we have no plans for the global south whatsoever. And that's one of the things we now start to advocate for, to get satellites there. So when you would have a satellite like that, let's see if I can get this working. Yeah. So this is the one over Asia. You have about every hour, you have a measurement during the day because we need the sun. So at night, we cannot measure. So that means that you really have a lot more measurements over Africa or South America when you would have a geostationary satellite. So let's see if I can get out of this slide. Yeah. So we are working. We think that we need two geos over Africa. It's a huge continent. One can measure Middle East and the northern part of Africa, and the other one the middle part and the southern part. And so we initiate this. We work with scientists in US, United States and Europe, but the first thing we now are doing is trying to reach out to scientists in Africa, because we really want to do this with the scientists in Africa for many, many reasons. One of the reasons is that with Tropomi, my experience is that it's really difficult to interpret the data if you do not work with the people living in that specific country. Because it has such a high spatial resolution, you really need to know what's going on the ground to understand what you see with the satellite instrument. Yeah, this was my last slide. So I hope that I convinced you that the OMI and Tropomi instruments led to new findings in the air quality domain, that we have new capability also for greenhouse gases, especially methane. It's important for COP28. And we are building this air quality constellation, and we need to add the global south to that. And I hope that you also convinced that emission regulation, so the Montreal Protocol and the movie of Obama, is effective. So when we control our emissions, we can be effective and we can measure that from space. That was it.
Let's give Dr. Laveld a hand for this great talk. And let's open the floor for questions. If you have a question in the audience, raise your hand.
We have to head out.
It's okay.
Thank you very much.
Yay, you're welcome.
It's gonna get here. Do we have questions in the audience first?
Oh, one shot.
PhD over here. Okay, if we don't, do we have one?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
I have a question on it's kind of the mechanics of the thing, but you said you download gigabytes of data per day. So I think you only have about two opportunities per orbit to download data, is that right? So you don't have any issues? I mean, you have a couple of station near, I don't know, Norway and down in Antarctica to download data?
Yeah, so usually for the polar satellites, you need two ground stations on average. And they are located in near the poles because they're this broad band state overlap. So you can basically download with one of the, one is in Kuna, I believe, you can download 10 of the 14 orbits. And then and then they push the data down in during the crossing of about 10 minutes, you can receive the data.
And so that works fairly consistently without any issues at that data rate?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We have an online question about data as well, which is, are the data these satellites collecting publicly available?
Yes, I didn't tell that, but yes, they are. So OMI data is public available via NASA. And the TOPOMI data is public available via the EU and ESA Copernicus sites. And they are available, most of the products are available within 3 hours after measurement, with the exception of methane, because that retrieval is complicated and takes more time.
Any questions from the room before I move on to an online question? So we have a question from Edward, who said, you can use IR light sources for spectroscopy from Earth, but can you use the sun, the moon, or other satellites as light sources?
Well, in this case, we use the sun. You can also use the thermal radiation from the Earth. So there are thermal infrared measurements. We'll also measure air pollution, but it's not the type I talked about. We also have satellite measurements which basically use the moon or even stars as a light source. But when you, for example, use stars, then of course you measure the higher part of the atmosphere. You cannot really measure what's going on ground, but you can measure 20 kilometers up to 80 kilometers altitude.
Questions in the room? It's interesting. Yeah. Have questions?
So are there any satellites in orbit that use on-orbit light source, like a laser, to look down to the ground and look at sort of tomography? Yes?
Yeah. So we have several LIDARs. They are usually used till now for clouds and aerosols. Also for CO2 and methane, there's a French development to use LIDARs for that. But one very famous one is Calypso. It's a French-US collaboration. It's flying, it flew, it stopped now in the same, not far from the OMI satellite. So we had a whole train of satellites passing one spot on Earth within 10 minutes or something like that. And Calypso was part of that. And that measured aerosol. But when you have that, you can really measure the aerosol vertical information. So you know exactly what altitude the aerosols are or the clouds. So it's used for that. But it's with that, you don't have data coverage.
I'm going to ask Pedro's question. He is writing to us from Mexico, and he wants to know if there are seminars or events where people can learn how to use this data.
Very good question. It's one of my ambitions here at this institute to get a series developed so that people can really use the data, know how to use it, because that is, you need quite some knowledge to really use it effectively and correctly. It's not easy. I know that EUMETSAT has courses on how to use this data, but they are usually directed at scientist level. And I'm not sure to what extent they are. They are open, but I'm not sure how well that is outcasted, that people can find that.
Let's go with question on data reporting. Will you be reporting to policymakers in order to inform future policy?
For the ocean hole, that's formally, we do that formally. So every year there is a meeting. They use the OMI, the TOPOMI, the GOM, the OMPS, all the satellite data we have, and they are used to assess if the Montreal Protocol is still effective, if the ozone layer is recovering, if you see that recovering continuing. So that's a formal process. But for air quality and greenhouse gases, I think it might start now for methane, but it's not formally accepted yet, because methane and all the other trace gases, the formal requirements for how much you may have is connected to ground-based measurements.
All of the questions are online today. So we have another question online. This one's from Bernadette. And she wants to know if all trace gases are concerning. And as a follow-up, Why is nitrogen dioxide so important?
If all trace gases are concerning, that's a tricky question. Well, let's see, let's say oxygen, you could also view as a trace gas, is something we need. I'm not sure if everything is concerning in that aspect. CO2 is not directly toxic, for example, but it is the strongest greenhouse gas. And it's important because it has a huge impact on climate change, and it's still the most important trace gas we should try to minimize to cope with climate change. The challenge with CO2 is that there are many challenges, but one is that its lifetime is so long, it's hundreds of years. So if you would stop all CO2 emission now, and then still that effect you will only notice generations from here. When you reduce methane, we have effect in 10 years. So it doesn't mean that you should not reduce CO2. We have to do it. But we also should look a little bit broader so that we have some compensation in the years to come.
Our last question on mine. Can you comment on the need for geostationary measuring satellites over South America in addition to Africa?
Yeah, well, that's on our list. So we first want to try to get them over Africa. That will be a long advocacy process. But also South America is on our list to get the geostationary satellite over. And Australia would also be good. Yeah, but the population increase in South America is from different order than in Africa, and that's why we have our first priority for Africa.
Are there any more questions in the room?
Peter Nell, do you have any advice for aspiring scientists in the audience on how to have such a successful career in the sciences?
Stole my question.
Well, work hard. I think one of the most, to get whatever successful career, the most important for that is that you're really, really interested in what you do. Because it will take a lot of hours. That's the bottom line. And when you look at my work fields, my lab at KNMI, for example, but also the lab here. There are all kinds of people there with different backgrounds. We have mathematicians, we have chemists, we have physicists, we have meteorologists, we have geoscience experts, you know. And all of that, with all the different backgrounds, you can work in this field. So it's not like you have to have only one choice at university or whatever, and then you have to do aerospace engineering, for example. It's not a requirement. I didn't do it. I studied chemistry and then physics, and I end up in this field. So it's a very broad field to some extent, broadly receiving scientists from all capacity. But the most two important things, I think, is you should really be interested, and only then you have the stamina to work a lot.
If there are no more questions, let's go ahead and give Dr. Peter Nell Leveld another round of applause for that excellent talk. And with that, I'm going to go through the message at the end. Thank you all again for attending this incredible lecture on air quality. As a chemist, I have never felt happier at a lecture as part of our Explorer series. I hope to see you all again on April 24th. For our next event on the intricate relationship between climate and climbing routes. This is going to be a different event, and it's very exciting for us. If you're interested in more Explorer Series events, definitely check out our website for upcoming lectures and conversations, as well as to view recordings of past events, including the one from today. If you are 18 years or older, please take a moment to fill out our 3 to 5 minute anonymous survey to help us better understand the impact of the program and how we can improve our next event. The survey will close on Monday, February 12th. You can find the survey by scanning the QR code. You can also ask a staff member if you would like to use If you'd like to use one of our tablets to take the survey. And with that, I hope to see you all next time. Have a great rest of your evening. Thank you so much for coming again. This was great.